Hello and welcome in the Media Division. Today we're going to have a look at the different sensor sizes and film formats that are used in the industry. We're going to go all the way from a 1/3-inch sensor that is used in iPhones all the way up to the IMAX format. And we're going to do so using the graphic you just saw that gives you a realization of how big the size differences actually are. And I'm going to give some examples with it. Of course, there's a couple of more different formats that I left out, and it's usually variations of the formats that have usually died out by now, but I think this simplification is well enough. So let's go. We will start with the 1/3-inch sensor. There are smaller ones, but none of them is relevant for filmmaking. You probably have one of those in your phone. In our days, these sensors are most often used for social media diarrhea. But this size was also used in three CCD camcorders that were popular around the millennium. Danny Boyle's iconic 28 Days Later was mostly shot on such a camcorder. If you were born in the 70s, your childhood films are most probably shot on Super 8 film. In the professional realm, it never gained much traction except for training or as a stylized approach. This is from the 2005 short, The Man Who Met Himself. Just a little larger is the 1-2/3-inch sensor found in the GoPro Hero 3 and in the DJI Mavic. Bringing us to the broadcast evergreen 2-3. Most studio and live sports cameras are still using this class of sensors as they are easy to focus and allow for extremely wide zoom ranges. Surprisingly, episode 2 and 3 of the Star Wars prequels were shot on early Cine Altas that used sensors in the 2/3 size. We step up to the full 1-inch that is used in the Phantom 4 Pro drone and many pocket cams. Way more relevant is the larger Super 16mm film format, historically and even today in independent pictures, mostly as a cheaper alternative to 35mm but also for its grittier look. Great movies like Leaving Las Vegas and Black Swan have been shot on 16mm, even though the budget might not have been a limiting factor. A large jump leads us to the Micro Four Thirds standard. Here we find a fan favorite from Panasonic, Olympus and Blackmagic design, as well as higher tier drone cameras like the DJI X5S. Our next stop is a big one, as we enter the family of 35mm sizes, and there are many. In the digital realm, we often find HPC and slightly differing sizes to be used synonymously with Super 35mm formats, where there are many sizes as well. Historically, it makes sense to start with Academy 35. That was the leading cinema standard from 1932 until the widescreen revolution starting in the early 50s. The 1.37 to 1 aspect ratio is very close to the 4:3 ratio used in the pre-HD TV and almost all classic movies like Citizen Kane,
Put it down.
Casablanca, It's a Wonderful Life, and The Thief of Bagdad all used it. Today it is used for mostly nostalgic reasons, and of course Wes Anderson is the kind of director to do so in some of his movies. Another modern installment is the Oscar-winning feature The Artist. Our next stop is the gold standard of cinema, until today, the Super 35 full aperture. After TVs found their ways into most households, cinemas needed a novelty to fill their seats. Widescreen, so a wider aspect ratio, was born. There were many competing systems with slightly different aspects, but we will simplify it for this short journey. The most iconic way to achieve a widescreen is the use of anamorphic lenses during filming and projection. This allowed most of the production chain to be unaltered. The scope has a certain look that's still popular, maybe even more than ever. A lot of iconic movies were shot in scope, like Blade Runner and the Alien movies. And in more modern times, films like La La Land, and of course, it works in digital sensors, just as well like here in Ex Machina and in It. Of course, Super 35 widescreen can be achieved by just cropping the image or by using a Super 35 that doesn't use the full height, like 3 perforation Super 35. A lot of iconic movies have been shot on Super 35 and cropped to widescreen, like Goldfinger, E.T. And it is still popular in cinema and high-end TV productions like the glorious Westworld. The list of Super 35 films shot on film and digital is endless and is growing steadily. The full-frame 35mm comes from still photography, and it was the format that started the DSLR filming revolution with the Canon 5D. Ironically, it hasn't played a big role in TV or cinema productions other than as a B or crash cam. Some TV shows, like the later House seasons, were shot entirely on 5D using the full frame crop to 16:9 aspect. The full frame is also the entrance to a new field of sensor and film sizes that are becoming more popular with evolving technology and a need for nostalgia, the large format, or short LF. As full frame is considered a large format compared with the cinema standard Super 35, it is usually included in the definition. The first true LF format is VistaVision, but films shot entirely in the format are very rare. One of the few better known is Hitchcock's Vertigo. VistaVision was widely used for special effects, shots given extra vision and less grain. For example, the original Star Wars movies and Dune used it. Tron's computer animations were rendered to VistaVision, while the live action was shot in 65mm, which brings us to another format that has historic relevance but is revived in analog and digital versions. 65mm, a wide negative or sensor, achieves a wide aspect without anamorphic lenses, but some processes are still using anamorphic lenses with a squeeze factor of 1.25 for an ultra-wide image. Just like VistaVision, it was often used for special effects shot for the same reasons, like in Blade Runner. Classic films like Kubrick's 2001 and Lawrence of Arabia are shot on 65mm negative. Tarantino resurrected the analog format for The Hateful Eight, and business giant Arri has added the Arri 65 to their rental program. This digital 65mm version has a slightly different dimension, but not in a relevant way. The Renovant is a prime example for the capabilities of the Arri 65 and the future of large format filming. In our journey, we pass by the smallest medium photography format, the 6-4-5. That might become an LF standard in the future. It is interesting, as lenses are available at reasonable prices, and they're quite future-proof in terms of sensor coverage. Our last stop is the IMAX format. While there are IMAX digital formats, they rely on smaller sensors like the Arri 65. The king of all formats is therefore still analog film. It is a full height format that again gets us close to where we started from, a 4:3 image. As IMAX is very expensive, and because of the equipment's size and weight, it has mostly been used for documentaries. But in the last decade, it has become more popular in feature films. Especially Christopher Nolan likes to use IMAX for many sequences in his movies, like here in Dunkirk and in the heist sequence of The Dark Knight. IMAX is often used when an extra little bit of cinema magic is required, as it claims to be especially immersive, like here in Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. We will talk about that in a second, but for now, our journey ends. I would like to talk a bit about the implications of what we just saw. Of course, larger formats have their drawbacks. They're usually heavier gear, heavier cameras, larger, heavier lenses, etc. But there's nothing that couldn't be overcome potentially by technology, meaning that, of course, we could have a radical new approach to lenses or something. But even existing lenses, like this is, for example, a Mamiya 6-4-5 lens, and it is surprisingly light and small for 80mm lens with such a big image cycle. If you want to see how this would look on a Super 35 sensor, I tried this on even a very, very small test, and you can check it out right here. Let's talk about the positive things that we can have using larger formats. Of course, the same reason why we talked about this in the piece, You have just more light hitting a larger film or sensor, which gives you potentially less grain, more resolution, or larger sensor resulting in less grain and a cleaner image. This is always nice to have because this will also mean potentially a higher dynamic range, etc. All nice things to have, and I guess you're all for it, I'm all for it. Give me that. But are there other aspects as well? And the answer is yes. Of course, we all know if you want to keep a somewhat same distance, you have to go much wider on a smaller lens with a wider lens, and that will cause distortions that are unpleasant to your talent. And if you're shooting architecture and buildings, etc., it makes everything a bit wobbly. The depth and separation, not only in terms of sharpness, but in terms of perspective, is very different with larger sensor. And there's a lot of videos on that on YouTube. You should check it out. In general, it's just said that it is a perspective effect that is closer to the human eye, and therefore is very easily acceptable to our brains. And we make a very nice perspective rendering out of that. And it's beautiful. Having said that, if we look at the Star Wars episode 2 and 3, I'm not a big fan of the prequels of Star Wars. I don't know who is. I would say that just visually, something like The Dark Knight, the heist scene is completely shot in IMAX, is vastly superior to the prequels. But this is a matter of taste. Would you say that it looks vastly better? I mean, look at the relation that the sensors actually have to each other. This is massive. Does that really, really show in the quality? I'm not too sure about that. I'm very interested in your opinion about the meta subject and how you think the future will evolve our gear. So leave us your comment and we will be happy to respond to that, and I hope we have a nice discussion about it. Please subscribe to our channel. You do so by pressing that button and like this video. I'm very thankful for your support. See you around next time.